The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one I call Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that a large volume of data has been published onto the dark web following the recent cyber attack on NHS Dumfries and Galloway.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is working with NHS Dumfries and Galloway, Police Scotland and other agencies, as we have done from first being alerted to the cyber attack, to assess the level of this breach and the implications for individuals concerned. At my request, NHS Dumfries and Galloway have briefed local MSPs on the situation and issued a statement to staff and the public. A dedicated telephone helpline is now open to the public, and the Scottish Government continues to provide support to the Board as they deal with this ongoing situation and the live policing investigation.
Colin Smith.
Presiding Officer, there's nothing more personal than someone's medical data, so this serious development will be deeply worrying for patients and staff of NHS Dumfries and Galloway, who will all be asking the question, does this breach affect them and their loved ones? NHS Dumfries and Galloway now know what data files have been released, and that is a substantial amount of data, including on children's health. But we also know it will take time for them to work through their data to identify which individuals are affected. Now, given how important it is that any vulnerable people who may be impacted by this breach, what specific resources are being provided to NHS Dumfries and Galloway by the Scottish Government to ensure the search of data is conducted as quickly as possible and individuals are identified and supported?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Colin Smith for his question, and I concur with him that for patients and staff across NHS Dumfries and Galloway, this is not only very personal but also a very worrying time. And I not just accept that, I acknowledge that that is the case. As I mentioned earlier, I'm limited in what I can say. However, I can inform Colin Smith that the Scottish Cyber Coordination Centre within the Scottish Government has stood up the Scottish Multi-Agency Cyber Incident Support Arrangements. These arrangements bring national agencies, including the National Cyber Security Centre, Police Scotland, National Crime Agency, the NHS Cyber Centre of Excellence and Scottish Government policy leads together to support Dumfries and Galloway to respond and recover from the incident. And as well as practical advice and support, the Scottish Government has alerted the wider public sector to the incident and shared relevant information. This, I hope, will enable public sector organisations to take preventative steps to defend against similar attacks.
Colin Smith.
Ransom demands from the perpetrators of the cyber attack were never going to be met, so it was always highly likely they would follow through with their threats to release this data and cause the maximum disruption and distress. Now that data is on the dark web, what assessment is the government made of the likelihood of other criminals being able to access this information, notwithstanding how challenging that is, then being able to use that information to target individuals whose data has been released? Because that will be a concern for patients and staff in Dumfries and Galloway.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Colin Smith for his question, because I think he's absolutely right. Breach of confidential data is an incredibly serious matter, and I want to reiterate NHS Dumfries and Galloway's call for staff and the public to be on their guard for any attempt to access their systems or approaches from anyone claiming to be in possession of data relating to them. And if anyone finds themselves in this situation, they should contact Police Scotland immediately by calling 101.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This worrying attack comes at the worst possible time, adding to additional pressure to already hard-pressed staff and to a health board who are struggling to find huge funding cuts. As well as making that IT support available, will the Cabinet Secretary explore what additional emergency funding can be put in place to ease those pressures at the board and make sure that the Chief Executive can focus on sorting this out rather than having to balance the books at this exact minute?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Oliver Mundell for his question. The There has been minimal impact in terms of patient care as a result of this. However, I do know that this incident has resulted in the need for some staff to change working practices in the short term, and I'm very grateful to everyone who is working to ensure people still receive the best possible care while we work at pace to ensure a return to normal working practices. The Government has made significant investments to all boards. We've seen a real terms increase to NHS boards as a result of the most recent budget, and of course our teams continue to work with boards across the country on their financial resilience, and should there be particular asks, then of course I would be receptive to at least hearing them, even if during a very difficult financial situation as we're all facing across the public sector, I may not be able to commit to fully being able to realise those.
Emma Harper.
This latest announcement about the cyber attack displays the very real implications for staff and for the public of cyber attacks, with personal details now freely published on the dark web. We also saw just yesterday how China successfully hacked the UK Department of Defence. These attacks are going to continue to happen with serious consequences. Can the Cabinet Secretary give a commitment that the Scottish Government is examining the cyber resilience of all our public institutions to protect the public and indeed those working in these vital services? And can the Cabinet Secretary to just reconfirm that it is adequately supporting NHS Dumfries and Galloway to have the resources needed to assess and action this cyber attack?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Emma Harper for her question. I can give those assurances. We continually review and regularly audit all health boards' cyber resilience. Emma Harper would understand, for security reasons, I can't go into detail of that, but they take part in an annual audit process assessing their effectiveness against the public sector cyber resilience framework, and it allows them to be as resilient as possible, reducing the likelihood and impact of cyber attacks. And that has aided their ability to respond promptly when this attack was discovered, minimising the impact to staff and the public. And in the most recent round of audits, the Scottish Health Component Authority, Competent Authority, noted that auditors found Dumfries and Galloway had demonstrated clear commitment to the audit process.
Finlay Carson.
Presiding Officer, we know that 91 folders have been published on the dark web, including highly sensitive information surrounding patients' confidential records and staff details. And while I appreciate there will be details of the attack that cannot be discussed and that the Cabinet Secretary will be taking advice from the National Cyber Security Unit, can I ask if he knows if the network was exploited because of a weakness in the security system or if someone's credentials were used? And furthermore, can you set out exactly how technically the NHS and Dumfries and Galloway are being supported to ensure all systems are back online, which will help address anxiety and the concerns of patients and staff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Finlay Carson. Reiterate what I said in response to Emma Harper, that the NHS boards go through regular annual audit processes in terms of their cybersecurity, and the authority that conducted that noted Dumfries and Galloway's clear commitment to that audit process. He'll understand that I can't go into significant detail around that for obvious security reasons. But in answer to his follow-up question around patient services, there has been minimal impact on patient services. The majority of patient services have continued as normal. Patients should have noticed very little change. However, I'm conscious that there is the possibility of continued impact, which is why we're continuing to support them in ensuring that they are able to recover from this as quickly as possible.
Tess White.
There was a major cyber attack on NHS Scotland in 2022, which crippled the NHS systems and disrupted services. So what steps were implemented then to prevent a major breach like this from happening again, and why did they fail?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've said, in response to previous questions, the audit process of reviewing cybersecurity across all elements of the health service is kept under constant review, and it's an annual audit process for which, as I've already set out, the competent authority confirmed that Dumfries and Galloway was cooperative with that process and I believe has done everything possible to prevent it. As we've seen from cyber attacks conducted elsewhere, this is an incredibly difficult time to defend against what is increasingly sophisticated actors that are looking to infiltrate our systems, including the Ministry of Defence most recently. So all that we can do is continue to support support, learn from the situations that have gone past and ensure that our resilience is as strong as possible. And that's what the Government will continue to do, not just with the Dumfries and Galloway, but with other health boards and public sector organisations going forward.
Question number two, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of recently reported developments, what plans are being made to support the continued operation of the Grangemouth refinery?
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government continues to engage extensively with owners of the Grangemouth refinery and is committed to securing a long-term sustainable future for the industrial cluster. The future configuration of the Grangemouth refinery is a commercial matter for the owners. However, we have a track record of supporting businesses at Grangemouth as they progress their low-carbon projects, and we are committed to working collaboratively with Petroenius to accelerate its own projects at the site.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her reply, and I hope she will join with me in paying tribute to the positive campaign that has been run and is being run by Unite the Union. And it's aptly called Keep Grangemouth Working. And I, as a Conservative, have no hesitation in backing that campaign to keep Grangemouth working, because the campaign asks three things: to extend the lifetime of the refinery, invest in new technology, and support for greener and cleaner energy projects. So from her engagement with Petroenius, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm Martin Williams's front page story in the Herald this morning that the hydrocracker has been restarted? And what impact does this return to sustained profitability mean for extending the life of the refinery?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased to join with Stephen Kerr in recognising the work of Unite the Union. And by extension, I should like to again put on record my thanks to the workers at Grangemouth, the highly skilled workers who contribute so much to this asset of strategic importance to Scotland. As regards media coverage today, I am, of course, aware of it. It explores the issue of the hydrocracker at the Grangemouth refinery. This is purely an operational matter for the company and one which is commercially sensitive. It's not appropriate for me to speculate or to theorise on what is essentially media speculation at this point. But what I can assure Stephen Kerr and indeed the Chamber is that ministers and officials engage regularly with all those with an interest at the cluster, including with the business, to understand the impact of current operations, of course, with an interest in their operation today and how that progresses into the future.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I thank the Minister for her response, but I hope that she would agree that it is a matter of interest for her and her team to find out whether or not the hydrocracker has been restarted. I think we have it from multiple sources that it has, and this is a significant development. Now, I can't help thinking that this window of opportunity that the restarting of the hydrocracker brings is not unrelated to the end of the Bute House agreement. And I want to echo what Derek Thompson of Unite has said in the light of the return to healthy profits for Petroenius at Grangemouth. He said, "The only sensible commercial decision to be made is to maintain the refinery's operations and in doing so retain 500 highly skilled jobs." I say hear, hear to that. Investing in cleaner and greener energy projects at Grangemouth is a major strategic issue for the whole of Britain. So I ask the Minister, both governments must work together with local interests to secure the future of the site and the local economy. So what discussions has the Cabinet Secretary had with UK ministers and what have they agreed? And in addition to the local council, Forth Valley College and Petroenius, which other local businesses have been recruited to the Grangemouth Future Industry Board?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'll be glad to share a copy of the cast list for the Grangemouth Future Industry Board with the member. It's quite extensive, and so I will do that in writing. I would encourage him, given the importance he places on this and that I do as well, not to theorise or indulge ourselves in theories about political configuration on the one hand, yeah, and what is essentially commercial matters. Absolutely. For Petroenius to take on the other. But allow me to restate, firstly, that it's not appropriate for me to comment on media speculation, but to reinforce the point that ministers and officials are very closely engaged with the development of these matters. And I suppose close my response by highlighting that our objective, given the strategic importance of Grangemouth, is to maximise transition opportunities, to minimise any gap between those emerging and transition happening, and all of that with a view to securing as many jobs as possible.
Yeah. Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all agree on the need to secure the refinery and jobs in such an important industrial cluster in my constituency. However, we also agree on the need for this to be done sustainably. So to that end, can the Cabinet Secretary update on the calls to the UK Government removing the regulatory barriers around sustainable aviation fuels and thus allow a future possibility of the site as a biorefinery?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Michelle Thompson is absolutely right to highlight the opportunity of biorefinering as a potential transition opportunity for the cluster. Ministers have made several representations to the UK Government for engagement on issues surrounding sustainable aviation fuel. Initial indications did suggest that the UK's proposed post-Brexit SAF mandate would inhibit HEFA use, a key inhibitor thereafter to the development of SAF. However, more recent developments do appear to present a more positive picture. But we will continue pressing that. I am in ongoing dialogue with UK ministers, both in the Scotland office and in the Department for Energy on this matter. And I will be very glad to keep Michelle Thompson up to date on that, given I understand her, her concern for this issue.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth will be published this month? And does she acknowledge that staff who work in Grangemouth need assurance that their skills, their knowledge, their experience will be key to the just transition to cleaner, greener energy projects, which can make Grangemouth successful and Scotland leaders in renewable energy and meet the aspirations that Unite are expanding as absolutely critical for us to support? Now.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I agree with a great deal of what Sarah Boyack has said. Our Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth Industrial Cluster will outline what will be a truly first-of-its-kind vision for the site, outlining the long-term operations that we would hope to see take place by 2045. Beyond that vision, the plan will also set out and chart a series of actions that will be required to secure that vision, focusing on securing long-term investment, developing technical and commercially viable solutions for manufacturing, and how we foster the correct policy environment for all of that. And the work to finalise the Just Transition Plan is underway just now, and I expect it to be published very soon indeed.
Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Having raised the need for urgent action on this, I welcome the news that we are hearing that Petro-Ineos has invested in and has restarted the hydrocracker, and that the site is turning a profit. The Save Grangemouth campaign that was headed by my Westminster colleague Kenny McCaskill aligns with a recent survey by Unite Union, strongly indicating that there has been collective failure on Grangemouth support by governments. What substantive commitment will the government now make to ensure the long-term sustainable future of this core asset to Scotland's energy industry that is not a cliff edge for both workers and Scotland's energy security?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Government is absolutely clear about the strategic importance of the Grangemouth complex. That's why its future and future-proofing the complex is a priority for us. It is important to our economy, it is important to our energy mix, it is vital to the workforce of Grangemouth and to the communities around it. That's why, whilst decisions regarding the companies and the site are for the commercial entities in control there, we are determinedly working with all parties with an interest on a future plan. We are meeting all of those who have a stake, we are investing, including in plans for future low-carbon study opportunities, and it's why we are planning. And I would just end by restating that point, that our ambition is to maximise transition opportunities, minimise gaps and secure as many jobs as possible.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answers so far, and yet she stopped short of committing to the publishing of the Just Transition Plan. Can she confirm that it will be published by the end of the month? And given that if you look at the Scottish Government's webpage, the Future Industry Board, it states that it's updating its workstream priorities for 2023, 5 months into 2024, is she comfortable with the pace and the volume of actions it has been taking to date?
In relation to the substantive question, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And in respect of the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth, as I said in response to Sarah Boyack, the work to bring both the vision and the actions that will be set out in it are nearing completion, and the plan, I expect, will be published very soon indeed.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.